The Trans-Tasman travel bubble have been reignited this week, with talks now underway for a flight path to be up and running before Christmas. It comes as Australia and New Zealand desperately work to kickstart their devastated economies and breathe new life back into our struggling tourism sectors.
But the move is not without criticism, concerns now being raised over the practicality of the plan. And for more on this, we are joined by New Zealand Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern in Auckland. Thank you so much for your time this morning, PM. It's lovely to see you. Can we come for Christmas?
Well, I think firstly we should just acknowledge that we do, as strange as it might sound, actually miss each other. And so we have been working quite hard to try and get some arrangements underway. Australia's changed its position up a bit. You know, previously there was a bit of a view that you wanted movement between states before you'd be looking to New Zealand. Now the proposal from Australia has been to move to a hotspot regime. And so we're just working through what that would mean. You know, look, for New Zealand, we have had a plan and a strategy of just having our community free of COVID. So we will just need to make sure that that hotspot regime works on our side too. But we're all quite dedicated to making it work in the future.
PM, how is it going to work? I mean, what needs to happen in order for this travel bubble to get up and to get working? And what's the timeframe on it, do you think?
Yeah, and of course we need to all keep in mind that things can change at any time. You know, obviously Australia's had its experience in Victoria. We've had ours recently in Auckland, and so we're all very mindful of that. What we'll need to work through is what the definition of a hotspot really means. You know, at what point will Australia say, OK, that's an area that we will put up a bit of a border around and we won't have travel to? That will then determine whether or not, you know, in our minds, that will be sufficient just to keep everyone safe. So a bit of work to be done, and both sides will need to be comfortable with each other's arrangements. But what you can see is that we do want to make it work. We want it to be safe. We want everyone to be comfortable with it and know that we are safeguarding our own strategies as we do it.
So just what you're talking about there with these hotspots, does that mean, say that we had an outbreak in southwest Sydney, you'd want to ensure there's some sort of perimeter around that area so no one there could get out? Just a little bit of clarification on that, if you don't mind.
Actually, the person to ask for clarification for that would be on the Australian side. For New Zealand, of course, we don't have those borders that we enforce in the same way, obviously. There is a benefit
to being
small.
But you'd need to be comfortable with who was coming
in. Australia that's proposed... Yeah. Indeed. So we would just need to be comfortable that if there is a flare-up, that it's contained. Mm-hmm. And so for us, it's about contained as in we wouldn't have people from that area who would then be travelling across the Tasman. You know, we are working to maintain a COVID-free status so that when people are able to visit us, they can move around the whole country. They can visit our hospitality. They don't have any restrictions on their movements. So that's what we're trying to maintain in New Zealand. We want our New Zealanders to enjoy that, and eventually when Australians are able to come, we want them to enjoy that too. So we're trying to maintain that. So it will depend on how you choose to operate your hotspot regime.
Also, is there an occasion where you might see deals being done between states and New Zealand, even though the borders are a federal issue, obviously? Would you see travel, say, between Queensland and New Zealand, or between South Australia or Western Australia and New Zealand? Is that potential?
Yeah, I mean, we've actually previously been asked, said that you know, that's something we've always been open to. There's been a number of states, obviously, that have had, you know, a huge success with COVID and have had status that has meant that, yes, you know, that could be a possibility. But so much of that actually just comes down to the decisions that Australia chooses to make going into the future.
There's also this issue of ensuring that those travelling through our airports, your airport and our airport, don't come into contact with someone travelling in from a high-risk country.
Yes.
How would you manage that?
Yeah. We've already had our airports working on basically segregating passengers that are coming through on flights that would be that would potentially be in the safe travel zone, keeping entirely separate from others. The flights themselves are actually something that needs to be resolved too. We've been working through that. At the moment, a lot of our Trans-Tasman flights are acting as transit flights, so they'll have passengers from a range of different countries on them. We'll need to make sure that when we are in the position to open up, we just have those who are travelling from within New Zealand and Australia, and when they move through the airport, they're not mixing with anyone else.
Few countries, PM, handled the health crisis better than you and New Zealand. It did come at a huge economic cost, much greater than Australia's. Did you go too hard?
Oh, well, I would dispute that premise of that question. Actually, our unemployment's been lower, our debt is lower, and, of course, there's a while to run, I think, till we see the full impact on the likes of GDP, but we should also, of course, keep in mind both countries had similar goals. We wanted to keep our people safe, you know, and I absolutely stand by that decision we had, which was go hard, go early. It meant we lifted our restrictions sooner than many others. We got our open economy back and our death rate was low. You know, and ultimately, you know, what is an economy without a healthy people? So that's been the basis of a lot of our decisions.
I mean, your economy contracted a little over 12% compared to Australia's, which was about 7%. You as a governor, are you still seeking elimination?
Yes, absolutely. And of course, elimination, keeping in mind, is just really an approach of zero tolerance for cases. As soon as they arise, it doesn't say that you won't experience them. As soon as they arise, just, you know, getting in really hard with your contact tracing, your testing, your isolation and quarantine. And so that's our strategy and that's what we continue to do. And again, as I say, it's meant we got ourselves open up very, very quickly. We're already seeing a very strong recovery. In some cases, we're seeing, you know, our exports looking stronger than last year, filled jobs, you know, retail card activity, all of those signs that things are coming back strongly for us.
You had subtle things to say to our Prime Minister earlier in the year. Are you two still talking?
I was going to say, if that's subtlety, then I obviously,
like
obviously didn't read the room quite. And that's the nature of our relationship. I think that we can do that. You know, nothing I said publicly, you know, I didn't say privately, you know, very transparent. And it needed to be said, though. You know, it is an ongoing irritation in our otherwise very strong relationship. And so, you know, I've got to speak to that.
Well, you have an election coming up. We always say the polls don't really matter, but 30% ahead, it's a fair lead. Are you quietly confident?
I'm one of those politicians that, you know, cannot and will not, you know, take anything for granted, not least because, of course, I probably wasn't expected to win the last election, and so very aware of that. But we are getting close now. Of course, polling in New Zealand opens on Saturday. Polling for Kiwis in Australia starts from today. So it is now upon us, but I'm certainly not taking anything for granted.
I think it's wonderful, PM, that obviously there are plenty of Kiwis here in Australia watching right now. It's scary to think, don't you think, that Australia could decide the outcome of the New Zealand election?
No, every single vote counts, including those Kiwis in Australia. There's a number of them. They're almost the equivalent to a seat.
Yes. Very aware of that. Also, I know with interest too, the All Blacks want to come home and quarantine for Christmas. I have an answer for all of that. I know they have to maybe come home and quarantine, but maybe they stay here and become Australian citizens and join the Wallabies. Fair enough.
Well, you've co-opted so many other things. I'm surprised you haven't already claimed the All Blacks as your own.
We're taking Russell Crowe and Crowded House.
That's fair, I think. I think that's all fair.
Yeah. Clover, Crowded House. The list is long.
But just very quickly, because you've been tipped to win a Nobel Peace Prize, so has Donald Trump. Of course, there is a big debate taking place there in the US today. Do you like him? Do you like Donald Trump?
I don't really know Donald Trump. Obviously, my experiences are very quick exchanges when I have them. You know, my job is to make sure that I'm a strong advocate for New Zealand, no matter who is in the job. And that is the position that I continue to hold.
What a very political, smart answer.
That's not like you, PM. It's not like you.
No, that's called diplomacy.
We know you don't mean it.
101.
Hey, PM, great to talk to you. All the very best in the coming weeks for the election. You've led your country through very, very difficult times in the past year, and we appreciate your time today a lot.